Hi, in this video it's all about the bass and kick and how to make them sound well together with just EQ. So let's go! So you just saw me record a bass groove on a little drum groove. I think this particular one was from Scott's Bass Lessons and there was no processing on this bass track at all. I just went straight from my Rode-Horn P-Bass into my A-Design's Red DI, which is a tube DI box. And from that I went into my Pacifica preamp and then straight to the AD converters. Now if we look at the Cubase project for this, you see that I have my bass track on top and this is basically a stereo down mix of the drums that I use to record my bass to. So let's have a listen. Yeah, so a pretty nice sound, I think. Now, as for the drum track that you're hearing, this is actually a fully processed drum track already. Let's have a listen. So this is quite mix ready already, but I also have the separate drum microphones. So basically two room type microphones, some overheads, three kick microphones, two snare microphones, a hi-hat, and that all comes together in one group track. But what I actually want to look at now is the kick and the bass. And all the separate drum tracks over here are not processed yet. So let's have a listen to the combination of the unprocessed kick and the unprocessed bass. So as you can probably tell, compared to the stereo drum track with processing, this still requires a bit of work. So let's have a look at what's happening in the low end with the FabFilter Pro Q3 first. By the way, the only plugin on this channel so far is my Britson console emulation, which I'm using for gain staging. So it has increased the level of the bass a bit. And now I'm going to put a Pro Q3 on there. And on that equalizer, the bass spectrum looks like this. So it's peaking here around 90-100 Hz. If we now want to look at the kick spectrum at the same time, we can add it on the sidechain. And then over here we can say that we want to see the sidechain also. So in this case, the red spectrum was the kick drum and the white spectrum was the bass guitar again. And what you can also see in this case is that FabFilter is showing the collisions of these two tracks. It does this because I have enabled show collisions over here. And it shows the collisions by a red glow in the spectrum. So the collisions happen here around, well, somewhere between 50 and 80 Hz, I guess. And that is because both instruments are quite present in that frequency range. And you can also hear that they're like kind of in each other's way. Now, one way to deal with that is by complementary EQ. So let me show you what that means in this case. So I'm going to put my bass EQ a bit on the right here on my kick track. I'm also going to put a Pro Q3. So the kick is on the left. And the bass is on the right, and I will leave that sidechain option enabled on the bass EQ so that you can still see both spectrums in that same plugin as well. Okay, so what you can see over here in the kick spectrum is that it has its fundamental around 60 Hz, and then it drops off, and it does have some high order stuff, mostly in this 3-4K region. So let's start by first putting some EQ on the kick. And that will be a low cut filter, but I'm boosting the Q so that it actually emphasizes the point where I do the cutoff. And I'm gonna put that around fundamental of the kick, which was around 60 Hz, so I'm gonna put the kickoff slightly lower. Now at the same time, we saw that in this region and around 100 Hz, there was a lot of bass activity. So I'm going to cut out some of those frequencies, so that the bass will have some room to shine in that region. And at the same time, we want to hear the click of the kick as well. So we're going to boost a bit in this region to emphasize that click part of the kick. And now I'm going to do a similar thing on the bass frequencies to make room for the kick. So I'm going to cut the bass frequencies again with a bump. There is a lot of bass activity, and I'm going to move this up to, well, around here. And I'm going to cut a bit around the 5K region where the kick has been raised. And I will also cut the bass a bit around the vocal region to make some more room for the vocal. And I'm actually going to do the same thing on the kick drum, which also doesn't need a lot of presence over there. So let's have a listen again. And compare it to the sound without any processing. Yeah, to me it already sounds way better now, where the instruments are much less in each other's way, but you can still see that collision glow in the bass plugin, so it's not the goal to completely get rid of that, because that's not going to happen. But at least it alerts you to a certain frequency range where there might be a problem. So if you're also hearing the problem, then it might be good to have a look at that specific frequency range to see if anything can be corrected over there. Now, if you don't have FabFilter, the standard Cubase EQ can actually also show you both signals at the same time. So let's have a look at that. And let's go to the regular Cubase equalizer. So if you play this, you see that you also get the bass spectrum in this plugin, but it's also possible to put a second track in there. So again, we can do show kick as well. And then again, you can see that both signals are quite present in this 50 to 100 Hz region. So that might also clue you in on a certain frequency range that's overlapping, so you can see what can be done over there. Okay, so at this point you might be thinking, hold on there, Lanewood Studios, aren't you cutting out too many bass frequencies? Because the fundamentals of the bass are actually quite low. And yes, you are right. If you look at what I'm cutting out for the bass, basically my cutoff is 80 Hz. And everything below 80 Hz is slowly getting cut more and more. And if you look at the bass guitar, the low E string on the bass guitar is actually around 40 Hz. And one octave up is actually around 80 Hz then. So the whole first low octave on the bass guitar is actually something that we're reducing with this equalizer. But that's not necessarily a problem, even if you play in that range, which is quite common, of course. Let's have a look at another recording that I did. And over here, you can see that I have recorded just the lowest note of that groove that I was just playing, which was a G on the low E string. And if you look at FabFilter for that recording, so if you play a bit of that low G, so you can see that that little bump here at the bottom, that's a low G, but there's many harmonics of this string that also ring out, and a stronger harmonic is even at 96 Hz and above that and above that. So the actual sound of the bass guitar comes from all of these harmonics together with the fundamental. So it's not that much of a problem if you lower that low fundamental a bit, because the other frequencies of that string still make it sound like you're playing the low G, and actually your mind will actually fill out that low G even when it's reduced in volume, because it knows that's the way a low G string on the bass sounds. And that's actually a trick that a lot of plugins, like for example RBass from Waves, are using to get a better bass sound on systems which cannot actually reproduce a lot of low frequencies. They just add those upper harmonics, and your mind, your brain, fills out the actual lower fundamental of those harmonics. So that's the reason why it is still okay to cut out a bit of that fundamental to make room for the kick drum and still be able to experience the bass in its full glory. Now, if you feel that the low end of your bass guitar gets cut away a bit too much by the low cut filter, then you can always change it to a low shell filter. And then you can determine exactly how much lower you want the low frequencies to sound compared to the rest of the bass guitar. And of course, what I'm telling you here is not the only way to make the bass guitar and the kick drum sound well together. Because another way, for example, is to use sidechain compression on the bass guitar to make it duck when the kick drum hits. But I might make another video about that. As always, if you like this video or find it useful in any way, please share it, give it a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, and ring the little bell icon when you want to know when I post another video. Now in the next video up here, I'll show you the full processing of a bass track in an Awash song production, because obviously there's more to it than just EQ. So have a look, enjoy, and see you soon.